Welcome. We start with the parallel session. The first speaker is Richard Patterson. Richard Patterson is professor of philosophy, PhD, University of Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. Your books are Imagine of Reality in Plato's Metaphysics, Aristotle Modal Logic, Presocratic and Plato, Plato's Parmenides.
Settled, I can announce to you, I radically changed my topic. I'm going to talk to you about sticks and stones. No, I'm just kidding. For half an hour, we'll have a break from the sticks and stones. But then we'll be back. Socrates speaks in the Phaedo of different sorts of iti, factors responsible for something or causes. Including what one may call a final cause, where the goal or end or purpose is at least partly responsible for something coming about, a formal cause indicating what a thing really is, and a physical or more generally mechanical cause, the mechanism that brings something about. This much is relatively uncontroversial. However, there's dispute about whether or not Socrates, in one key instance, conflates physical causality with logical or definitional connections, or, as Gregory Blastus maintained, reduces physical to logical necessity. The first order of business here will be to address that issue. I'll argue that Socrates did not conflate the two and that the charge rests on mistaken translation. Secondly, I'll suggest that one aspect of the Phaedo's conception of participation is the root from which the timaeus notion of place or space or the receptacle develops. Thus, the Phaedo is a more complete precursor of the ideology of the timaeus than is usually recognized with respect to how things come to be and are and cease to be. So, as for the translation, the Phaedo's final argument for immortality cites participation in or having a share of forms as the idea for why worldly things are they as are as they are. Socrates extends this to cases in which one form always brings up another form with it, as two brings even, snow brings cold, and so on. This allows a more clever, more sophisticated, and informative idea. Instead of saying that something is cold because the coldness in it, or it's having a share in coldness, one can say it's cold because it's snow, or odd because it's three numbers, and so on. And snow always brings up coldness, as three brings up oddness. This more clever explanation appeals to a different sort of ITF than that which Socrates invokes to explain the fact that he's sitting in bondage. In that case, the true and final cause is his decision to stay in prison rather than escape. By contrast, odd-numbered because three-numbered and cold because it's snow involve formal causes. Three is by definition an odd number. Snow is essentially one type of cold thing. In neither case do we have the sort of connection nowadays thought of as a cause, which would be something more like a physical or efficient cause. Socrates does mention physical causes several times, however, including in his sitting in prison example, where these causes are the sinews and bones, these tensings, relaxings, and movements are mistakenly thought by some to explain why he sits where he does. But to call these things the causes of his sitting in prison, says Socrates, would be absurd. They are merely that without which the real cause, i.e. his thinking it better to stay rather than escape, could not be the cause. It's worth noting that nowhere does Socrates speak of forms as efficient causes. On this important point and several others, I entirely agree with Gregory Blastus. is a classic paper, Causes and Reasons in Phaedo. Forms appear in the Phaedo only as final and formal causes, to use a later terminology. But Vlasis also argued that in some cases of his clever ITI, Socrates treats physical causes as establishing a necessary, not just contingent, connection between cause and effect. First, he presses the example of extreme heat or sickness, pleuritas, and nosos for sickness. Pleuritas, he says, must be taken in its literal sense of burning heat, fiery heat, citing LSJ. And it is precisely excessive heat that Plato takes to be a cause of a variety of ailments, in all of which the patient is feverish. That's at 86A, 2, and 3. Second, Vlasis asserts that the occurrence of fever is the cause of the occurrence of sickness, would be a textbook example of a cause in Greek medicine, or by cause he means a physical cause. Third, he reasons that one must not take pleuritas at Timaeus 86a to be itself a kind of disease, but rather as simply an excess of heat or fire. Four, he argues, if one takes pleuritas to be itself a type of sickness, then the cleverness of the idea in sick because of pleuritas is lost. For these three reasons, Vlasis concludes that Plato has here asserted a necessity between physical cause and effect that, quote, expresses a physical law that has logical necessity, or that constitutes a reduction of physical to logical necessity. Now I'm going to skip about eight lines. Go to page four at the top. The threefold mistake here, I say, is first to think that pleuritas is simply excess of heat, as opposed to its being fever. Second, to think it's mistaken to think that fever, pleuritas, is a physical cause of disease in Greek medicine, when in fact it's actually itself a type of disease or one of the essential components of the disease. And third mistake is to say that pleuritas nosos is a case of physical cause and effect. It's a necessary and even definitional truth. Plato might say it's a metaphysical truth in that pleuritas is essentially is a type of nosos. Okay, so fever, malaria, and the correct reading. It is correct to say that Vlasis, Timaeus 86a, 2 to 3, recognizes excess of fire, pleuros hyperbole, as a cause of sickness. But the Timaeus passage as a whole, in fact, supports the translation of pleuritas, not just as excess of heat, but as fever, as pleuritas, not pleur hyperbole. Both there and in our Phaedo passage, it should be translated as fever. Indeed, the Timaeus passage reflects the usual classification of fevers, pleuritoi, from about 400 BCE on, by Greek medical writers into continuous and intermittent fevers, intermittent ones then subdivided into quotidian, tertian, and important fevers. Tertian and important fevers are what we now call malaria, for example. Plato relates differences in periodicity among fevers to excess of different so-called elements. Excess of fire produces continuous fever, air quotidian fevers, water tertian, and sluggish earth quartan fevers. Thus, Timaeus sees excess of heat, pleuros hyperbole, as a physical cause of one type of fever, pleuritas, where the latter is a type of disease. And so also, I say, the pleuritas should be translated in the Phaedo just as it is usually translated. All of the translations I checked translated as fever. I say the traditional translation is correct. Take it as fever and as a type of disease, just as we would think of yellow fever, scarlet fever, and so on, as diseases. This means that pleuritas is not the same as pleuros hyperbole. Pleuritoi are actual diseases, nosoi, that in some cases are caused by pleuros hyperbole. Consequently, the link between pleuritas and nosos, fever and sickness, is not that of mechanical or physical cause to effect, but is necessary and even logical or definitional, and in Plato's view, ultimately metaphysical, since pleuritas essentially is a disease. So this responds to the arguments about the translation of pleuritas and the causal role of excess heat in Timaeus. As for the argument that Horatos is a textbook case of idea of disease in the medical writers, Hippocratic corpus principally, I have not found any instances of that, but I found many instances of Horatos being described as disease. From the epidemic, many of them in the epidemics, for example, book one, the first constitution, section two. The majority of cases, the symptoms, the pathemata, were these. Fever with shivering, horatoi. Fevers with shivering, these continuous, acute, not completely intermitting, but of the semi-tertian type, remitting one day and coming back stronger the next. Or another passage, death came more promptly than is usual in consumption, and yet the other complaints, which will be described presently, though longer and attended with fever, horatoi, were supported and did not prove fatal. Actually, I'm told that about 60% of the cases he describes in the epidemics were fatal. And so on and on, there are many, many such passages, so I'm not sure where the idea got started that horatos is just excess heat and it causes disease. It really is a disease and it can't be fatal. All right, what finally then about the argument that taking horatos to be a type of sickness was precluded from serving as a clever idea of disease? This argument is especially puzzling because on the interpretation defended here, the one Blastos rejects, horatos is an idea of sickness is clever, or sophisticated, or informative in exactly the same way as Socrates' other examples. Just as it is more informative to say this, a group of things is odd-numbered because it takes freeness than to say simply that it takes of oddness, so it is more informative to say that someone is sick because he suffers from fever than just to say he's sick because he suffers from sickness. So I just don't understand how that argument has any traction at all. So I think that, as far as I can see, that clears up the point about whether there's collapse in the distinction between the physical and formal cause and Phaedo, there is none. Still, page six now, what are the larger implications of any, if any, for the Phaedo passage for the intrinsic nature of efficient causes or for how they actually work? I think there are no such implications in the passage. Let me skip to the next paragraph. For an account of both of how specific efficient causes operate and of how Plato does, in fact, explain the cosmos theologically, one turns to the Timaeus. Still, the account found there remains an expansion and detailed filling out of the basic ideological framework in the Phaedo. And let's skip to the next section, a precursor to the receptacle. And now, of course, I'm on to the second part of the paper, where I step back and look at the general frameworks for explaining how things come to be in Paris and Barr in these two dialogues. However, Timaeus adds to the basic framework of nous-formed participants that we had in the Phaedo a striking factor that appears to be entirely absent from that earlier dialogue, namely a receptacle for things that come to be, something like place or space in general. I would like to mention the suggestion that Socrates does in the Phaedo adopt a way of looking at participation that at least foreshadows Timaeus' notion of receptacle. I see this in the implications of Socrates' use of spatial and military metaphors in the Phaedo and their parallel in Timaeus. When, for example, an opposite such as smallness advances on the largeness of something, the latter cannot remain in amid smallness, but must either retreat, evacuate, withdraw, or perish. And if some advancing or attacking form always brings into the field an opposite, then the item being attacked cannot admit either the attacking party or the opposite being brought up. Burnett notes the liberal use of military imagery throughout this section of the dialogue, and again, translations regularly reflect this kind of usage. In Socrates' picture in the Phaedo, it seems to be the spatiotemporal entities, such as individual humans, or instances of snow or fire, or n-numbered groups of such entities, or a little later on, souls, that are occupied metaphorically by one or another form, or a bit more literally, occupied by a form instance or a form in us. Any occupiers that are themselves opposites, hot, cold, hot, even, or that always bring up an opposite along with them, must either retreat or suffer destruction at the advance of opposed forms. Accordingly, the occupied territories, the items that have received or admitted certain forms, are the territory or the field for which opposed forms do battle. One could pursue this feature of the military metaphors further in a manner that Socrates does not, by seeing this contested ground more broadly as place or space or territory in general, territory that is divided up among participants and forms, and which can be taken over and occupied by other forms. Taking this territory yet a bit more abstractly, it would be place or space in general that receives form instances, or those form instances may in turn be displaced from that territory by others. Of course, the reader will recognize at this point the receptacle of the timeous in which worldly participants must come to be, and recognize also, I hope, a plausible sketch of how that conception might have developed from Socrates' more limited and less well-developed image of certain form instances being in something, some area or territory, some place or co-op, for which they do battle and which they may occupy or abandon. By contrast, Timaea speaks expressly and more abstractly of kora or topos, which lacks a distinctive nature of its own, so can receive any form. Beyond that, he struggles to describe this receptacle, but firmly asserts that it is a necessary postulate of his account, and puts it to use in ways that we call the Phaedo's military and territorial imagery. For example, visible fire is a portion of the receptacle in which fire has come to be, or that is now flame. Thus, in terms of the regular solid, this is where microscopic regular pyramids predominate, flows in tiny pyramidal volumes of the receptacle. When masses of water surround a small portion of fire, the latter may, quote, put up a fight, but be defeated. The conquered fire can break up into fragments and may then regroup as particles of air. And 57B has further instance of this. It's language of conflict, escape, defeat, and victory. Of course, Timaeus also analyzes, as Socrates does not, analyzes these transformations mathematically in terms of the number and shape of the constituent triangles and particles of fire, water, and air. But the military and territorial imagery is just as striking as it was in the Phaedo and reflects the same fundamental intuition something receiving instances of forms, something that forms metaphorically enter into, and that can potentially be occupied by other form instances. And I'll conclude just with this last little short paragraph. I'm not suggesting that Socrates or Plato in the Phaedo have the Timaeus conception of space or the receptacle in mind. Rather, the Phaedo picture of worldly forming images as being in or occupying something, and of a kind of battle among forms for occupation of these loci of forms in us, is the root image from which the Timaeus generalized the more abstract conception of the receptacle, space or place, develops. So in the interest of saving time for discussion, I'll stop right there.
Or forms in us, or whatever you want to call them. Do you have any additional thoughts on that? Or? I mean, because in your paper, you might want to say, oh, they're just going to move into other particulars, which are kind of parallel to what the receptacle is in Timaeus, or?
Yes, well, it's been some time since I read or heard. I heard David said his paper some time back, so I took the morning off. So I don't remember precise, but I get the gist of what you're saying. I think, in fact, and he may have argued this, that possibly what you get in the Timaeus is one thing coming in and the other being destroyed, and it can regroup as a different element. And possibly the only reason Socrates puts the option of retreating in there is that he's making preparing for the argument about the soul, because unless that is an option for soul, then you go off somewhere else rather than be destroyed.
Well, for example, when a particular...
I just had a thought just now. But what about when the wind comes and you've got very warm air here and a cold wind moves in and pushes the warm air to another area? I think that would be an example.
Yeah, well,
so I was wondering about... So at least some people have thought that we're getting a variety of examples. Here, some of them seem more mathematical, some of them seem more invisible, some of them more visible, and that the point of that is to show that all these bearers, that there's general features that apply to all the bearers, regardless of what sort of thing they are. I think David suggested this, Nick Denner suggested this. So, what I'm wondering is how metaphorically we should take the military metaphors in the Phaedo, in particular the spatiality of those metaphors in the Phaedo, and then if it's fairly metaphorical in the Phaedo, how much does that connect with the Timaeus, where I take it we don't want metaphorical place, but we want somehow something that's a little bit more like spatially extended place. So how much is this, you know, entering into and retreating a sort of metaphor, in which case it's not clear to me how much of a connection we have.
Yeah, nice question. You don't have to take it very metaphorically in the Phaedo. That is, if I'm cold, there's coldness in me, and it might be my arm is cold, or it might be my whole body feels cold, but it is there in this place, this area. So it's literally there. And so, yeah, I said metaphorically, the form is in us. That, I think, is strictly metaphorical. And the Timaeus will make very, very clear the form is not in anything, and so on. But yeah, go ahead.
So I guess there's some people have wondered what's going on when I'm standing and everyone's standing still, and I'm larger than one person and smaller than another. What's going on with the largeness retreating or perishing, or the smallness retreating or perishing, and then also in the mathematical case, when the threeness retreats or perishes, how should we think about how that's working? It seems like it might connect back to the earlier question of when one is added to one, which is the one that becomes two. So if we're thinking of that as quite mathematical without any particular physical instantiation, it's not clear that we should be thinking in spatial terms there, but I mean, there's different ways to go on this, and I was just wondering if you think that sort of throughout all the examples we can give a clear sort of spatial account of what's going on.
Yeah, I was pushing in that direction most of the time, but I think you're right. That's a nice example that the 1 + 1 = 2. And I think what he's got in mind is correct, is there were already two before they came close to each other. But to make it special, you could say this is a two-membered group whose two members are not contiguous, right? You could say this is a one group, but its extension is part to here and part to there. Why not?
Can you hear me?
library, and the way you described it as if it all, was all about taking over territory. My question is about reading the receptacle in the time you use as place or space in general and being this like blank territory, because there are some images there like being an ekmageion, being imprinted by the form, and that suggests that it's not only forces fighting each other, but this receptacle is also something that, something else, another third element.
Yes. Yeah, I totally agree. Place or space, those are words. He uses horon, topos. Probably receptacle is better, because whatever it takes to be a potential receiver of all these forming images, that's what it is that he's talking about. And it may not, in fact, probably does not correspond. It certainly does not correspond to a conception of completely empty space, something like void. Actually, it turns out in modern physics, space isn't like that either. But we grew up thinking that way, probably. So I agree with you. And so I would not want to say, since you asked, I would not want to say there's a blank nothingness like Democritus' void. But it's very, very hard. It's like Timaeus has trouble describing it. I think it's Sarah Brody who has a paper in the Confess Trip about this, or rather subtle analysis of various possible readings of what this stuff is, but it's very mysterious and it's not blank. Blank. So yes, you totally.
Yeah,
the next speaker is Willie Costello. The title of his text is Platonic Causes in Context. Willie Costello is currently a lecturer and Andrew Mello Fellow of Scholars in the Humanities in the Department of Philosophy at Stanford University. In the spring of 2015, he received his PhD in philosophy from the collaborative program in ancient and medieval philosophy at the University of Toronto. Costello specialized in Plato, and while he interested within his subfield are fairly broad, his recent work has focuses on issues in Plato's metaphysics and early natural philosophy, specifically the relation between Plato's conception of causation and his conceptions of forms in the Phaedo. He's currently at work on a book on these issues, building on his doctoral thesis, From Causes to Forms, the Phaedo and the Foundation of Platonic Metaphysics. Okay, thank you. Thank you all for being here. And thanks also to the organizers for putting on what has been a fantastic week. I'll say that I'm more or less going to follow the paper that's included in the program, though I will have to kind of skip over some sections just for the sake of time. I'm also going to have these slides up here with some text and some notes, so you can also follow along here. Okay, well, to get into it, as we all know, in the final argument at Phaedo 96-107, Socrates seeks to discover the cause, or aitia. Over the course of the argument, he rejects a number of putative causes as not really causes at all, and accepts as genuine causes some fairly unconventional things. Now, my question in this paper is straightforward. How exactly is Socrates, or Plato, conceiving of causation in this argument such that the things he rejects as causes don't count as causes, and the things he accepts as causes do? So I will present in this paper a new account of what such Platonic causes are, proposing specifically that Platonic causes should be understood on the model of ingredients, and arguing that this conception of causation runs throughout the final argument. This account, I will show, has various theoretical and interpretive advantages over its alternatives in the literature. And more than that, this account will challenge the conventional assumption that the Phaedo represents a radical break from Plato's predecessors in its causal theorizing.
suggesting rather that we see the final argument as taking up and refining a model of causation familiar from Anaxagoras and others. Okay, so to begin, let's just review some known facts about Platonic causes. As commentators have long recognized, Platonic causes are characterized by three general principles. And these principles provide Socrates with grounds for rejecting the putative causes he rejects and accepting the genuine causes he accepts. Now, we've already seen these three principles already at this conference. Here's my version of them, complete with handy acronyms. So, first principle, the same thing cannot be caused by both of a pair of opposites. This is what I'm calling no opposite by Ti, or NOA. Second principle, the same thing cannot be a cause of both of a pair of opposites. So no Iti of opposites, as I'm going to call it, or now. And then finally, this third principle, a cause of F-ness cannot itself be on F, or what I'm calling not oppositely qualified, or not. Now, I think these three principles do have some intuitive plausibility, more intuitive plausibility than they're often granted, but if we take them to be meant to apply to everything we might consider a cause, we can see that they run into some fairly easy counterexamples. So, for example, it seems right to say, in violation of our first principle, NOA, that the opposites of fasting and gorging both seem like perfectly good causes of unhealthiness in the body, the same thing. Or in violation of the third principle, knock, we might think of the fact that a hard wooden meat tenderizer causes a cut of beef to become soft. So this is just some examples of how these principles can easily run into problems. Now, in light of these seemingly elementary counterexamples, the general response in the literature has been to assume that the principles must be meant to refer not to everything that might plausibly be identified as a cause, but only to causes of a particular kind. So this is what I'm calling Platonic causes, following the literature. And the general task in the literature thus has been to provide an account of what a Platonic cause is, and thereby elucidate the basic conception of causation standing behind these three principles and which led Plato to accept them. And to be clear, what we want to establish here is that this conception of causation which stands behind these principles is not merely ad hoc, as if Plato just arbitrarily set down a conception of causation which approved of the causes he liked and ruled out the ones of his opponents. What we want to show is that Plato is working with a sensible, incredible conception of causation here. Okay, so this task of providing an account of what a Platonic cause is, this has more or less been the task of literature on Platonic causes for the last 40 or 50 years, like everything since Plato. And the problem I see with the various existing accounts of Platonic causes out there is that, in my opinion, they failed to make plausible this third principle, knock. Now, some scholars, I think, have just outright dismissed this principle as an unjustified inclusion. So I think this is particularly true of those scholars who see Platonic causes as something like a logical cause or a necessary and sufficient condition or something like a formal cause, and just have focused on the first two principles at the exclusion of the third. Scholars that have tried to give some explanation of this knock principle have explained it by reference to kind of these ideas that like causes like, or the transmission theory of causation, or the principle that a cause is greater than its effect. But my feeling here is that those explanations are even more obscure and confusing than the principle itself. And so I don't really think they can really be used to explain the vast variety of examples we see Plato putting this principle to work in. And the problem here is that knock, I think, is the principle we should be most concerned to account for. So not only is it, I think, the least intuitive of the three principles, more significantly, it's crucial to the proof of the immortality of the soul at the end of the final argument, which, after all, is the entire reason the causal investigation at 96a is set in motion. Indeed, knock is the only one of the principles which the proof actually employs, and I put the proof just up here so you can see that. Thus, if we fail to make sense of knock, we lose sight of the argumentative context in which the discussion of Platonic causes appears. So what we need then is an account which does not shy away from knock, but rather treats it as the principle to be explained first and foremost. And this is what I'm going to try to do with you. Okay, so to review, what we're looking for is a conception of causation which will account for all three of the final arguments, causal principles up here, and especially this third principle, not. And now I'm going to set out a particular conception of causation which I believe will do just that. So to help introduce this conception of causation, I'm just going to go through a kind of ordinary example of how I think this could work. So suppose I have two cups of coffee, one bitter, one sweet, but otherwise the same. Now suppose I wish to know why the second cup of coffee is sweet. One perfectly natural way of hearing this question is as asking, what is it about this cup of coffee that makes it sweet? And one perfectly natural way to go about answering that question is to identify what it is that this sweet cup of coffee has and the bitter cup of coffee doesn't. Intuitively, after all, there must be something in the one but not in the other. Otherwise, both cups of coffee would be identical, both bitter or both sweet. And indeed, the relevant difference maker in this case is not hard to come by. This cup of coffee is sweet because sugar or some other sweetener has been added to it, whereas the other cup of coffee has been left black. So in this way, sugar is the cause of the coffee's sweetness. So call such a cause an ingredient cause. And here I'm introducing this new term, ingredient cause, in part because I want to emphasize that this is, I don't think, identical, or I don't think it perfectly lines up with any other notion of cause that we have out there. So I don't think it perfectly matches up with any of Aristotle's four, nor is it exactly how any contemporary philosopher or metaphysician is going to talk about a cause. So I'm just kind of introducing a new concept here. I'm calling it an ingredient cause. Now, a cause in this sense is something internal to the object in question, and which has, in some sense, been added to it. So to put it in a definitional formula, this sort of cause of something's f-ness is that which has been added to it, such that it is now f. Now, so far, I've only hoped to suggest that this is an intelligible way of specifying the cause of something's f-ness, just kind of in the abstract. But now we have this question, could Plato be conceiving of the cause in this way in the Phaedo? I actually think that there's good reason to think yes. Additive language, in fact, pervades the final argument. All its accepted causes are said to come into or to occupy or to be present in or added to those objects whose feature they are causes of. And there's lots of textual evidence to this effect. It's included in the full paper and I put it up here. I'm not going to read through all of these examples. But just note that this use of additive language is applied to all of Plato's accepted causes, both bearers, like fire and the soul, forms in us, which are of course in the things that they're causing, and even something like the beautiful itself, whose presence or association or whatever its mode or means of being added to the thing it's causing, is what's responsible for its being a cause. Furthermore, the very same additive language is also applied earlier on in the final argument to those putative causes which the argument ultimately rejects. So we see Socrates using the same sort of additive language at the beginning of the final argument where he's talking about portions of flesh being added to other portions of flesh and things like this. So therefore, from the very start, Plato seems to be conceiving of the cause as that which, when added to something else, makes it become thus and so. In other words, the final argument seeks to discover or rightly identify the ingredient cause throughout. And here I should note, I'm not actually meaning to make any claims about what goes on in the teleological interlude at 97 to 99. I think the cause there is something different, although it can be related in important ways to the ingredient cause. Okay, so this now brings me to a second point. That even if, in seeking the cause, one seeks to discover only the ingredient cause and no other, there are still various means by which one may sensibly try to discover and identify it. In particular, one may attempt to discover the ingredient cause via perception. That is, by looking at the object which manifests the feature in question, comparing it to a similar object which does not manifest that feature, and perceptually discerning what is different between them. For example, if one were seeking the ingredient cause of why this bunch of 10 grapes is greater than that bunch of 8 grapes, perception would say it's because the bunch of 10 grapes has 2 more. And this is sort of the example that Socrates gives early on in the final. Now, this may seem like a perfectly good explanation, a perfectly good specification of the ingredient clause. Yet, it is a central contention of the final argument that this explanation is no good, and that ingredient causes in general are not accurately revealed in perception. Rather, the final argument insists that ingredient causes must conform to an additional stricture, which perception generally disregards, that whatever it turns out to be, the ingredient cause of something's F-ness must itself be F, and be F in a stricter sense than normal. Now in the text, put that up there. In the text, this feature is signaled in a variety of ways in saying that a cause of F-ness always or for all time deserves the name or has the feature of F-ness. And textual evidence to this effect just abounds. There's much more than just the stuff I list here. So it's clear that Plato accepts this claim, I think. But importantly, I think this additional claim, this lemma, as I'm calling it, isn't just a point of Platonic prejudice. It is, in fact, I believe, a natural extension of the concept of an ingredient cause. So to illustrate this point, let's go back to our earlier coffee example. As we noted above, the ingredient cause of this coffee's sweetness is sugar, which has been added to it and which is itself sweet. Now it makes sense that this ingredient cause is something which is itself sweet, because if the sugar had not been added, then there just would be nothing sweet about the coffee at all, and the coffee would just be unsweet and bitter. In other words, it is in virtue of sugar's own sweetness that it is capable of making the coffee to which it is added sweet, and thus qualify as the ingredient cause of the coffee's sweetness. Furthermore, the sense in which the ingredient cause of something's F-ness is F is stronger than the sense in which ordinary perceptible F objects are F. For example, we say that this coffee is sweet, but it is not sweet kind of through and through. The coffee is also bitter and hot and brown, and these features do not contribute to its sweetness in any way. In contrast, the ingredient cause of the coffee's sweetness must be sweet through and through, as it must contribute wholly to the coffee's sweetness. And this means that it will be sweet in quite a distinct sense than the normal one. The important point for our purposes is just that it is sweet in a stronger sense. And to generalize, an ingredient cause of F-ness is itself perfectly F. That's how I'll just refer to it. Okay, so to sum up then, just put it up there. I propose that the kind of cause under investigation in the final argument is the ingredient cause. Now, as I have defined it, the ingredient cause of something's F-ness is that which has been added to it such that it is now F. And in addition, is itself perfectly F. So now we're ready to follow through on the promises of the beginning of this paper and see how the final argument's three causal principles all derive from this account of ingredient causation. Now, I'm not going to have time to go through all of these derivations here. They're included in the full paper, but I'll at least go through the first one so you can get a feel for how this is going to work. So the not oppositely qualified principle states, remember, that a cause of F-ness cannot itself be un-F. And this follows immediately from our account of ingredient causation. As we saw above, something is an ingredient cause of F-ness only if it is perfectly F, which means F through and through. And something is perfectly F only if it is in no way un-F. So there we go. That's just a very straightforward derivation of the not oppositely qualified principle. And indeed, I think our account makes knock look rather sensible. For if we were asking what has been added to something such that it is now F, it would indeed be monstrous, teros, if we pointed to something about it that was itself un-F. As if one were to explain the fluffy softness of a puppy dog by citing its hard, solid bones. Just makes no sense. Rather, we had better point to something about it that is F. And this line of reasoning is what I think stands behind and motivates not. So I believe similar derivations can be given of the other two principles as well. Again, I'm not going to go through them now. The second principle follows on much the same reasons. The third one, or Noah, is a bit more complicated, but I think it can also be done. But again, I'm just going to pass over that now to make kind of my concluding points. Okay, so despite everything I've said, and just granting to me that my conception of causation can be shown to stand behind our three principles, it may still seem that I've not said enough. So even if it is granted that ingredient causation is a credible conception of causation, and that ingredient causation can account for all the final argument's causal principles, and that Plato speaks of causes in the Phaedo in a way that is consistent with there being ingredient causes. Still, one may wonder, can Plato really have had this conception of causation in mind? Doesn't this all seem just a bit too convenient for me? Or more pointedly, how is ingredient causation not simply an ad hoc solution, my ad hoc solution to the interpretive problem of Platonic causes? Okay, so I see a couple of responses to this skeptical line of questioning, which I'm really only going to be able to gesture at this point. So one thing that I may do at this point is to point to the broader dialogical context of the Phaedo. As ingredient causation, I think, is precisely the conception of causation we should expect to find in the final argument, given everything else we're told about being and coming to be in the rest of the dialogue. So in particular, I think that ingredient causation pairs naturally with both the sort of elemental two-tier ontology we get outlined in the affinity argument, and then also with the analysis of coming to be that's outlined in the cyclical argument. I'm not going to go into these details now, but this is just kind of one way in which I think the conception of ingredient causation can be bolstered interpretively. Okay, so these points are just meant to show that ingredient causation fits well within the broader dialogical context of the Phaedo. Furthermore, I think it fits well with the surrounding historical context, as ingredient causation is hardly a conception of causation unique to Plato. So it is, for instance, precisely the conception of causation I think we find in Anaxagoras. So here's a representative excerpt from Anaxagoras, and we can see, you know, hair being added to hair and flesh being added to flesh and this sort of explanation of change or coming to be. This is pretty familiar, this parallel between Platonic causation and Anaxagorean causation is pretty familiar. Furthermore, I think there's another interesting parallel between Plato and the Hippocratic authors here. So in particular, I think the ingredient cause has strong affinities with the Hippocratic concept of a dunamis, so the various powers inherent in things and specifically in bodies, which manifest themselves as observable properties in accordance with the particular power they are. And again, I have a couple of representative passages up here. They're also in the full paper. But I'm not going to go into all of the details here. I just think this is another way in which the conception of causation, which I'm claiming Plato is working with in the final argument, is one that's not entirely unique to him. Okay. So just to wrap up then. Taking all of these responses together, I feel there is in fact strong reason to believe that Plato had the ingredient causal conception of causation in mind when composing the Phaedo. And if this is correct, it suggests that we must revise how we've been thinking about the dialectic of the final argument. Conventionally, the final argument is thought to represent a radical break from Plato's predecessors in its causal theorizing. Typically, it is assumed that Plato in this argument dismisses the materialistic explanations emblematic of various pre-Socratics, and in their stead introduces a hitherto unseen kind of explanation in terms of his cherished forms. Yet if what I have argued in this paper is correct, then Plato is not introducing a new kind of cause at all. Rather, Plato is here adopting an established conception of causation and refining it, getting more precise about its correct specification, and extending it to explain features which no one else had even ever considered. In other words, the problem with Plato's predecessors was not that they were after the wrong kind of cause. They too saw the ingredient cause. Their problem, rather, was one of misidentification. They got the ingredient cause wrong. As the final argument tells us, a person becomes big by the addition not of food, but of bigness. A group of 10 is more numerous by the additional presence not of two-ness, but of numerousness. In short, the true ingredient cause of something's f-ness must be something which is itself perfectly f. This, I think, is the realization of the final argument's causal theorizing. And this is also, as I've argued, the essence of a Platonic cause. Thank you.
The notion of the cause necessarily being perfectly F. I mean, you for most of your talk, you didn't really mention forms until the end. You start talking about, you know, at the very end, in your peroration, you talk about, you know, megathos and that sort of thing. I mean, so when you talk about the sugar, I mean, is there somehow, do you think that if we think of these bearers, like bearer of the F, you know, with them there, characterized by the F, they have to be perfectly F? So you think fire then is perfectly hot? I mean, so we have these perfect, and sugar is perfectly sweet. Okay, is there any, when you say sweet through and through, do you also, I mean, what exactly do you mean by that? Spatially or what?
Right, yeah, I mean, I sort of understand the force of question maybe as like, why am I not just saying essentially? Because that is, I think, the way some people go is that it's something that's essentially F. And indeed, a number of, a number of the things that Plato tells us about these causes, it seems like they can't continue being what they are and without being, you know, hot in the case of fire, without being even in the case of two. I just wanted to try to go away from that language just because I'm not so sure that Plato has a robust notion of essence and accidents in this argument. So I was just trying to give an alternative way of cashing this out.
Okay, so maybe just one last thing. Mm-hmm. But you are committed to the notion of perfect instantiation. That's what I'm getting at. These things are perfect, they have to be perfectly instantiated. That seems to be the new thing that you're talking about, but the perfect notion of perfection.
Yeah, and it's not just, you know, partial or something like that. It really is, you know, part of what they are.
Thank you. So that was really, really clear and interesting and helpful. Thank you. Two questions. One, you define ingredient cause as something internal to the object and added to it. And I'm not entirely clear on how this differs from, say, regular sorts of formal causes that other scholars talk about. So it seems like you must have something particular going on with the internal or the added. So is internal a spatial notion, and what exactly is the force of added? Because of course a formal cause is in some way added to the object, right? Let's say, just on a purely formal account, I become very just, right? In a certain sense, something's been added, justice, right? In virtue of my relationship to the form. So you must have some other notion of added at work. And then one last thing is, one advantage of your account is that you think with ingredient causes we have a better explanation of, I forget all the acronyms, was it NOQ? Anyway, the one where the cause has to itself be perfectly X. Mm-hmm. And I don't see why that follows from an ingredient account in particular, and I'll give you an example as to what's worrying me. So I know with drinks, I forget which one, but there's some kind of artificial sweetener that actually works by being very bitter.
Yeah.
So you put it in the drink, it's added to the drink, but it actually doesn't work in virtue of perfectly having the quality. So I don't see it as following from the first two attributes of ingredient causes that there should be this lemma. So.
Yeah, I've worried about that particular example too. And I mean, I think, you know, one thing I can just do is claim ignorance on the part of Plato and just, you know, maybe he's not aware of these sort of ways of causing. Or, you know, he also might not. I don't actually think Plato would accept sugar as the ingredient cause of sweetness. That was just kind
of
my...
Well, forget about the example, but just you think that the NOQ fits better with your account, but I don't see anything about the first two criteria of ingredient causes that's going to give you NOQ unless you just add it in an ad hoc manner. Better than it would on, say, a form as essence or formal cause type of account.
Yeah, so I mean, I think... So I think, you know, the burden is on my like sort of explanation of how the lemma about the ingredient cause being perfectly up, how tightly that can actually follow from thinking through this added criterion. And I don't know how much more I can say about that right now, but I take the point that like this might not seem to kind of necessarily follow from or be an essential part about this type of cause. Just one quick thing on your first question about what it means to be something internal. I mean, I take it that a formal cause might be internal in the right way, but the sort of cause that Plato is after in this argument extends beyond just that. So I don't think like the bearers are really as easily assimilable to this formal cause model. So I wanted something that was kind of a bigger umbrella term than just fitting in formal causes. But I do think like the sense in which formal causes are in things or added to them would be the right sort of internality, the right sort of addition for them.
Okay, so I was also worried about what Susanna was worried about, mm-hmm. the first part of her question. It seemed to me that it leads us to a conflation actually of parts and causes in some mm-hmm. sense. And I wasn't sure how actually examples, well, the example yourself gave about the meat stuff, well, how that would, could actually ever play out on the ingredient stuff. I didn't see how division, separation necessarily plays out. I mean, I can see you make a story, but I'm not sure that it works for all of them. So I felt there's a good couple of examples that you yourself gave that, that don't quite fit with that, and that just really actually give us a path. And also, I don't quite see that you really get rid of the like-to-like principle. It seems to me you're just actually making it, in some sense, more intensive, because it's not just like-to-like. It is, so to say, the thing itself. It's not just, you know, something hard making it hard. It's, so to say, an ingredient of it right now. Mm-hmm. And so I'm not quite sure that I understand why that is less obscure. I think you, I'm not quite sure whether you used the language of obscurity, but it was something in that similarity.
Yeah.
Helps.
Yeah. So I mean, I think that like the like causes like principle is less plausible when we're thinking of these as in this almost like efficient causal manner where you have a hot fireplace making, you know, my less hot or cold hands hot by transferring heat. And I think that's usually how people talk about the transmission theory or something like that. I think like that sort of model just doesn't really apply well to most other cases. And especially when, you know, Plato's talking about cases of something becoming even, or why is something even? It's not as if there's this really even thing that transmits some of its evenness to it. So I think a more sensible way of thinking about that is, you know, there's something about it which is even, namely its number, which is 2 or 4, or whatever the case may be. So I think the principle does become a bit more plausible when you're thinking about just what it is about this thing in it that is accounting for its F-ness. Although it does have this sort of triviality or simple-mindedness that's characteristic of this mode of explanation. On your first point, just about parts and causes, I'm not sure that, or I don't think that all of these causes need to be thought of as, you know, parts in a physical or a material sense, right? So I didn't want to suggest that. So things that we might think of more as forms, as Suzanne was mentioning, I think would also count as appropriately in or added to the thing. Although we might not want to consider them as parts, per se. I'm not sure I've said enough, but maybe we can talk more afterwards.
Right, oh
yeah, the meat example, yeah.
Short question.
Yeah.
last, yes. I just wonder how your account relates to exactly the question. How your account relates to essential predication, direct or indirect? It seems to me that, I mean, what I heard you saying was something like Plato doesn't really have such an account, but I find that extremely implausible. I mean, he has a very clear distinction between something participating directly in the form, which is at least an essence, I'm not saying it's simply an essence, but at least, and something doing so in some indirect way by participating in something else which participates in the essence. So I'm very puzzled that you should just say, I don't have to relate any of this to essential anything. I can just say, Plato doesn't really have a story.
Yeah, I mean, I guess to just further explain why I'm avoiding this language, I think that sort of language immediately like raises the question of, well, do ordinary things have essences? Or are these bearers kind of ordinary things in the same sense? And I think insofar as we want to think in those terms, I think ordinary things don't have essences, and that's a weird claim, and it seems like a really like strong claim that I don't think Plato is so much like explicitly committing himself to, but just kind of part of the theory. So that's maybe why I'm just avoiding this language, but I don't think what I'm saying is, I don't mean it to be inconsistent with this way of thinking about it. I just worry about it sort of misleading us or raising the wrong sorts of questions at the same time, for better or worse. Thank you.
Well, the next speaker is Rubens Sobrinho. Title is Images of the Soul, Palingenesis and Causality in Plato's Phaedo. Rubens Sobrinho is a full professor of ancient philosophy at the Federal University of Uberlândia, graduated in philosophy from the Federal University of Uberlândia, master in philosophy from the Federal University of Minas Gerais, and PhD for the same university under the guidance of Dr. Marcelo Pimenta Marquez. Has experience in the area of philosophy with emphasis on Plato, Pythagorean cult mystery, and Greek and classical ethics.
Good afternoon to all. I give my thanks to the organization of this magnificent symposium. Well, in this work, I intend to recast the role of palingenesis in Plato's Phaedo and associate it with the causality of the forms, particularly in the final myth, where palingenesis appears as a principle of unification between physical cause and ethical principles of action. I'm adopting here a psychological perspective. In the dramatic movement of the dialogue, Socrates proposed a tripartite definition of death. Death is the separation of soul and body. Do you believe that there is such a thing as death? Can we believe that is anything other than the separation of the soul from the body? And do we believe that being dead is the following? The body has been separated from the soul and come to be apart, alone by itself, and the soul has been separated from the body and is apart, alone by itself. Death is one, the separation of the soul from the body. Two, being dead is when the body comes apart from the soul by the separation. And three, being dead is when the soul is separated from the body and is apart, alone in itself. If the soul can remain in itself, it has a proper reality as a self. Philosophy answers a previous logos and perform a new sort of purification, that of assembling the soul and gathering itself from every part of the body, alone by itself, and to living alone by itself as far as it can. Phaedo 67c. The notion of palingenesis associates an ancient tradition, Palaios Logos, with the assumption that the souls exist in the Hades and return pali from death to reborn. Socrates develops arguments for the immortality of the soul in order to address the causality of beings. Only a rational exposure that the soul is immortal and survives the destruction of the body can give meaning to a retributive justice notion that depends on temporality. If death was the release of everything, there will be an annulment of the difference between the unjust life and the righteous life. If the soul actually is mortal, then it needs to be cared for, not only for the sake of the time in which what we call living and goes on, but for the sake of all time. If the soul is mortal, then there is a duplication of time. On the one hand, there is a short time of life. On the other, the totality of time. This opposition implies a consequential conception of justice. All the unjust acts and time of time of life are fairly compensated in the totality of time. The conception of justice generalizes the notion of causality if an effect inevitably follows a cause in time, then a consequence inevitably follows an action in time of the soul. The duration of human life is insufficient for such consequence. Transmigration establishes a relationship between the short time of the life and the time of the soul. As said Socrates, for if death were separation from everything, it would be a godsend for wicked people to die, and thus be separated both from the body at the same time, but also losing their soul from their own lives. As it is, however, since the soul is evidently immortal, it could have no means of safety or of escaping the abuse, other than becoming both as good and as wise as possible. For the soul comes to Hades with nothing other than its education and its way of life, which are said to confer the very greatest benefit or harm upon one who has died as soon as his journey there starts. The myth of the destiny of the soul intends to give meaning to the postulate that death is separation between soul and body, and it is the reason why the soul exists after the destruction of the body. The opposition between the time of life and the totality of time, past chronos, is for the opposition between the totality of the human beings and the totality of the divine. The separation between soul and body results in an inevitable destruction because it is part of the physis. Analogously, the destruction of the soul is the irreversible irrationality. The licentious way of life destroys the powers of the soul. Just as the destruction of the body depends on the physis, the destruction of the mind depends on the desires and on the choice we feel. But the destruction of the mind does not eliminate the connection between causality and injustice. Why does perversion imply an unpractical destruction of the mind? Because only choice determines the nature of the soul. Because the perversion, the mind, loses its powers. The participation of the time in the timeless whole suggests the participation of particular beings in the forms. Just as the forms are the cause of all beings, the totality of the conception should serve as reference and as causal principles for the actions of the life. Hence, the terrible risk of nothing, not taking care of the soul in the lifetime. Forms are intelligibility principles and cause of coming to be, and are causes and principles of action. The care of the soul presupposes the cosmological notion that the best must be sought in invariance. The salvation for the injustice of life is the practice of the opposite, a righteous life. The retributive punishment is a consequence of an unjust life. The reward of the consequence of a life of is excellence. The extent of causality for practical actions features a reconfiguration of the ancient tradition, according to which one comes to the Hades without having been admitted in the mysteries and initiation. Will be lying in the mud, but the purified and initiation will share, once arrived there, the company of the gods. Causality surpassed the old logos through an epistemology. The knowledge of the best requires the knowledge of the worst. Thus, the soul must strive towards the excellence and towards the best. The fate delimited by philosophical logos is not the punishment of empirics, but it is the natural causality. The soul is the cause of its own nature and destiny. That's what it makes it get to have this only one, only with an education and its states. The discourse about the fate of the soul is a reasonable myth that is the, in harmony with all previous arguments. The impossibility of the argumentative demonstration requires persuasion and incantation, whose effect is the creation of resonant beliefs. After the souls are sent to Hades and they are given what they should be given and stay for however long is needed, and then another guide escorts them back to these worlds again, after many long cycles of time. Phaedo 170. The cycle of Palingenesis is an analogy which reinforces the argument of opposites. The fate of the soul is a way of thinking the connection between actions and consequence through images. There is a multitude of ways in the destiny of the soul. Even after death, the soul has the power of choice. This suggests that the causal connections depend on dynamics of choice and soul liberty. The well-composed and wise soul, Cosmia Tecaifronimus, is not unaware what is going on wrong. Because of this, the well-ordered soul knows the best way of on others. The geography of the invisible world matches with the structure of Psyche. The geographic description of the invisible world represents a refinement of the ancient laws of transmigration in accordance with the hypothesis of participation in forms. All previous arguments contending for the soul immortality gives consistent to final move. The clusters of rational arguments in favor of immortality supports the hypothesis of participation and connects the psychological domain with physical sphere. In this way, this association between mythical images with the causality of forms reinforced the inextricability of myth and arguments that beget it. The myth sets up the spheres as an image of the symmetric order. The sphere suggests that time and space are cyclical on myth. A mutual correspondence links between different levels of reality. The world order is homologous of structures of values. The mythic space is to geometric space, as the sphere is to circular plane. The mythical time is to chronological time, as the lifetime is to totality of time. The linear, irreversible time is only a projection of the totality of time into the time of life. In the myth, space and time are equivalent aspects of the same soul's nature. Human experience is the plan of contradictions. The earth perceived is distinct from the true earth. The true earth is to our whole, as this whole here is to the depths of the sea. At one extreme, there is the ether, purity, and at the other, the density of the sediments, steam, water, and mud. There is a symmetry of ratios between opposite planets. The reality of man is proportionally more beautiful and pure than the depths. In the same way that the true earth is more beautiful and pure than human reality. If a man were like a flying fish and had wings, he could cross the frontier between states, lifting the head, would allow him to sustain the vision of a true life and of the true earth. Going from a state to another requires overcoming the limits of the debility that exists in each state of mind. Just as in the man world coexists contradictory opposites, so as in his psyche coexists conflicting opposites. Every paradigm supposes each opposite is the sign of the other, which adds its image. Each reality is an indication of the existence of the opposite reality, and both are image and reciprocal reflections. The greatness of totality, the proportion, the symmetry, the perfection of the spheres gives signification to the small and apparently flat extension of life. Passing from an inferior intelligence plane to a superior plane is to exercise of the philosopher death and his great combat. Death and philosophy represent the same end, the initiation to the truth. The Phaedo's final myth presents images that show the causality and the principle of causal determination of forms, operating in a visible model. The exact truth about the true nature of what affairs would require more than the time of a life. Socrates resort to the reasonable myth because the certainty and truth about these things are beyond the argumentative demonstration. Earth is spherical and is located in the center of the sky, and the absence of force guarantees the balance and keeps the Earth in the same position. This sphere's vortex is the most symmetrical of forms and gives rise to a simple explanatory model. The homogeneity of cosmos implies the regularity or invariance of the intelligible principles. The symmetry guarantees the reversibility and of the becoming process demanded by causality and by the essential determination of the forms. However, the intelligibility principles exposed in Phaedo demand the applicability in practical actions. The mythical geography is built as images of these principles, and the cosmology of myth comes from the principles previously established in the arguments. The intelligence has hegemony over nature because the intelligence gives significance to cosmos. The homology between the soul and the forms becomes a univocality. If the soul is sufficiently purified by philosophy, it will proceed without deviations to the pure intelligibility incorporeal in which desire impregnates the beautiful. The myth ends up with the conclusion that, by the presentation, everything must be done to a life of excellence and discernment, because there is beautiful and great is his expectation. Thank
you. We have 10 minutes for questions.
Posso falar em português? Bom, essa semana toda eu fiquei falando, insistindo no mesmo ponto, a respeito da teoria dos dois mundos. E hoje você falou mais de uma vez em invisible world, mundo invisível. Eu não sei, mas eu creio que pela terminologia do Phaedon, esse conceito não está em questão, E pelos conceitos que são apresentados tanto no Phaedo quanto em outras obras de Platão, não existe uma distinção entre dois mundos, segundo meu ponto de vista, entre dois mundos na obra de Platão. Eu creio que o mito final do Phaedo, com as suas regiões, tanto as regiões subterrâneas quanto as regiões além da superfície da Terra, eles, na verdade, não estão falando de dois mundos, até porque, se fossem mundos, seriam mais de dois. Porque ele fala de céus, do céu. Então, cada região da Terra tem seus céus, os acreditam. O verbo, né? Eles creem que aquilo seja o céu, mas o céu, na verdade, a luz está emanando lá do sol, né, no alto, sobre a superfície da verdadeira Terra. Então, eu gostaria que você, se você pudesse, comentasse um pouco sobre essa questão de por que você pensa a questão em termos de um mundo invisível. My question is about the two worlds theory, and I mentioned some passages of the Phaedo, in which we have not cosmos noetos, and not the terminology concerning a multiplicity of worlds, but we have only a terminology concerning different places and regions, which are unified in a coherent theory of a single universe.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I agree with you. This is an equivocal word. But I think that in Plato there's a clear distinction between topoi, a topos, and there are different topoi. So I should imply the word topos and not word. It's just a question of historical employment, but I agree with you.
Thank you, Rubens, for your presentation. This, just want a little bit more of development about two statements in your presentation. I think you said that the psyche is responsible for his own nature, and so my question is, which kind of nature do you have in mind? Ontological nature, ethical nature, and please give us a little bit more of the development of this. And the other statement is when you said that the geography of the invisible world is, I don't know if you say the same or similar to the structure of the psyche. My question is, which kind of structure of psyche is concerns in Phaedo? Please talk to something more about it.
Okay, concerning the physical cause, some scholars adopt postulate a semantical distinction between eidos and usia, like Alberto Bernabé and Monique Dixot. So I'm following this semantical distinction. There are causes that determines directly the beings, the particulars, essential determination. And there are others that are indirectly determination these particulars. The only form of the souls, at least in the context of the Phaedo, is the form of life. And so, the soul is also a cause, the cause of itself by its choice. And these are an indirect causality intrinsic to the soul. And by this distinction, the soul is responsible for its own nature. But the soul is indirectly determined by the form of life. It's inseparable. That's it. In the question of I think that there is a homology, structural homology, or must be have a structural homology between soul and cosmos. It's not an automatic thing. It depends on the choice of the soul. The soul must efforts to acquire this homology.
It's time to finish. We close the session. Thank you very much.